Welcome to the WildTake Show. Today we have Richard Sanchez, assistant editor on films such as Bill and Ted, Face the Music, Robin Hood, Naked, Suicide Squad, and Tangerine. Also one of the visual effects editors for She-Hulk. We discuss how he got into the industry, what made him want to become an editor, advice for upcoming editors, and his course, Master the Workflow. I hope you guys enjoy. As always, if you could like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell, and let's get into it. Hi, Richard. Thank you for taking the time today. How are you doing? You all right?
Good. How are you doing?
Yeah, good, man. Good, good. I really appreciate you jumping on today.
Happy to be a part of it.
Yeah, thank you. So we'll jump in with how you got started in editing or what made you want to be an editor.
Yeah, so it goes back to, 2001. I was a junior at UC Irvine. I was studying to be an actor. I was really into theater, really wanted to be an actor. Kind of hit a point where I was also coming to some self-realizations about myself, which is that, you know, I'm not a super hunky, super tall, you know, type that was going to probably be landing a lot of leading roles. So as I kind of looked into, you know, where I was going to fall into that, actually, I had pretty much decided I was going to be a lighting designer because I really liked the tech classes in my theater program.
Okay.
And I loved lighting design. I was like, oh, maybe I could do theater shows or, like, you know, do lighting design for like attractions at Disneyland, that kind of stuff. You know, one of our instructors did lighting installations and design for rides. And I was like, oh, that sounds amazing.
I'd not thought about a job like that, but yeah, someone needs to do it, right?
Yeah. And even down to basic things like, you know, figuring out logistics of like how to light a parking lot. I was like, oh, you need a lighting designer for that. And I was like, well, that makes sense. You need to think about, you know, where you're going to get proper illumination and what kind of, you know, angles. And, you know, so it was kind of like, it seemed like it was both an expansive world of work, but also it was super interesting to me. And I was very gung-ho about it. And then I had to take a studio art class to finish my major, and I was going to take black and white photography, and I was also very dead set on that. And a friend said, you should take an editing class. And I initially, actually at several times, just said no, and she would not let up on it, you know, just, you should take an editing class. So I was kind of like, I'll take the editing class. And it wasn't even an editing class per se. It was video art. So
okay.
It was a lot of kind of like very big on like Bill Viola and, you know, like installation pieces. It wasn't narrative and story per se, but, you know, it was my introduction to editing as a craft. It got me sitting down with Final Cut Pro. And honestly, within like 2 weeks, I was just like, this is all I want to do. I was very, I'd always been very into computers. And, you know, I think about it a lot in the sense of, if the craft was still done on moviolas and not on computers, I wonder if I would have even gotten into it. Because for me, the combination of storytelling of movies and technology was just super exciting to me. And so, yeah, within about 2 weeks of sitting down with Final Cut, I was like, This is all I want to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was at the tail end of my major in theater. It was too late to really change it to film. And UCI didn't really have a film program. They had a film studies program, but not really quite the same. So I was like, I'll finish out my major in theater. I still loved what I was doing, you know, didn't necessarily want to stop. And then just any book I could find, I jumped onto creativecow.net, which was kind of my film school. It, you know, it's like, it, I know it still exists, but, you know, as social media has come in, those tend to be more the, you know, the forums. But it, like, that place was amazing to see these experienced editors talk about, you know, craft and hardware and technology. And yeah, and that was really my film school.
You found kind of Creative Cow, your own Final Cut. What was the next steps for you at that point?
Well, you know, it was tricky because I was a very hard-nosed PC guy at the time. And okay, so, you know, Final Cut being Mac only,
yeah,
I learned, we were on Final Cut 2 at the time. God, it was so early, it didn't even have color correction.
Oh, wow.
And I remember Final Cut version 3 came out and it was like, ooh, color correction. But yeah, the closest equivalent was Adobe Premiere. In fact, it was not even Premiere Pro at the time. It was just Premiere. And I remember, like, I think my senior year of college, Premiere Pro came out, which was like, prior to being Premiere Pro, the interface was quite different from Final Cut. And when they went to Premiere Pro, it was obvious they were sort of emulating that, you know, look and experience. And so, you know, I would just do little things with my friends. We'd shoot stuff on mini DV and bring it in via Firewire. And, you know, I was into anime, so I would take these anime files and make music videos out of them. But, you know, it was tricky because at the time, I had certainly heard, you know, Avid is the way to go and Final Cut is a toy and everyone was making fun of Final Cut. And that was all I knew. And Avid was expensive, too expensive for me at the time for me to really dive into it. So I kind of toiled away with Final Cut and really just by proxy, you know, Premiere, and was doing my own little projects for quite a long time. I worked at Starbucks for probably 4 years before I really got a foot into the door. And my first assistant editing job was, it was for the History Channel. It was a show called UFO Hunters. And I was just a night assistant. And my job was, I would be digitizing DVC Pro tapes. We were using the Kona cards to down convert them and, you know, bring them in standard def. And that was my early, you know, my early jump into it. It was, you know, working 7 p.m. to, you know, quite honestly, they were long shifts. It was 7 p.m. to typically 6 or 7 a.m., you know. But, it, you know, it got my foot in. And it was still, you know, still trying to grapple with, you know, the divisions between the worlds, is because, again, you know, it was Final Cut. And so you run into people not taking you seriously, the NLE wars, which is always a frustrating topic, you know. And, you know, I still didn't even have a Mac, so it was hard to practice. You know, you could do what you could with Premiere, but it just wasn't quite the same. But that was kind of, you know, once I really started getting into it. And, you know, that was a job, it's so cliche, but, you know, I got that job by, I was, my first job that wasn't Starbucks, really, I was working for a company called GoTV. And it was cell phone video before the iPhone existed. So it was very primitive cell phone programs. Okay. I remember we had slideshows, which was just literally a slide with sound. Then we had what we called multi-frame shows, which is one frame a second. And then if you had a really good phone, you could watch 15 frames a second. And I mean, it was postage stamp size. I think it was 320 by 240. But at the time it was like, oh, look at that.
Yeah, insane.
So, and I was working there and we were cutting on Sony Vegas and I knew Vegas. So it was like, okay, cool. I can do this stuff. But they more and more, they had me doing a lot of camera work. So I was doing a lot of field shoots and I wanted to edit and I just wasn't getting, you know, I was asking to edit and, you know, they were just playing to my skills with the cameras. And I was like, well, I need to get going in order to get out of this, you know, to get out of this rut and steer my career in the path I want to do. And so I was doing a field shoot in Hollywood, and it's the most cliche story, but I was doing a field shoot in Hollywood, and from around the corner, an old friend from high school turns and I go, hey, how you doing? And he goes, oh, I'm assistant editing. I was like, wow, that's cool, man. I'm trying to get into that. And he goes, actually, I know a guy who needs a guy, you know, and you're like, okay, can, you know, you want to put my name in there? So it's, and I know that as a story is not entirely helpful for people who are trying to get into the field, especially people who don't live on, like, it happened on Hollywood Boulevard. It's so cliche. Yeah. Like, and I know that's not helpful for someone who doesn't live in Hollywood, like, oh, so I'm not going to turn the corner on Hollywood Boulevard, but that is literally how it happened for me. It's, you know.
And I think, but to be fair, I think that still plays a part in terms of networking. So, you know, knowing the right people and reaching out to people played a massive part. If you didn't know them in the first place, you know, they'd just walk past you just like anyone else. So.
And, you know, that very much becomes the case that's why it can be so hard to get your foothold in. Mm-hmm. But once you do get a foothold, no matter how small, it becomes so critical to nurture those relationships and make relationships, you know. Yeah. because it that's really where it all comes from. It's, you know, there's 1,001 resumes coming into every job posting, you know, that goes up there. And also, you know, just the truth of the matter is, by the time a job posting makes it anywhere near the internet, it's only there because word of mouth failed. And so word of mouth is always just the way to go. And it's always more valuable. You know, a recommendation from somebody is always infinitely more valuable than any resume.
Yeah, I think I can agree with that, because they're already in that industry or they already know this person. So it's a massive step up. And no one really wants to go through the headache of interviews and going back and forth with numerous people. And, you know, so I can imagine this play a massive part in that as well.
And also, you know, some people interview very well and sometimes they have a good poker face, and then you get them in the chair and they just choke. And that's unfortunately the truth of the matter. And I think that's why it can be so hard, one, to get in, and two, to traverse worlds. Like, if you're trying to go from reality to scripted, it can be really hard to get in. And I think, you know, I feel like the reason for that is everybody always says, I'm smart, I'll figure it out. And most of us are and do, but I think for anyone who's ever hired someone who said that and it didn't quite happen, there's always that, yeah, but remember that time and remember the headache. And that's on one hand, I empathize with the position that puts anybody from hiring in, but on the other hand, it creates borders between, you know, worlds of editorial that I think are not totally true. Maybe a kernel of truth, but not a lot.
Yeah, so take me through, you've done the whole thing with the History Channel, UFO mm-hmm. hunters, you've got this assistant editor job, potentially mm-hmm. from his friend, you know, then kind of what happens from there? Where'd you go?
So from there, you know, I was really into technology mm-hmm. big time. And so when I came to this job and I saw they had HDCam SR and D5 HD decks, I was like, I want to learn how to use those VTRs. And it's kind of funny how, like, you know, a lot of folks were like, yeah, I don't want to touch that. And I was like, that's cool. So I went from assistant editing to online editing in the second season. And I just really loved online. And then from there, it was, again, the luck of the draw. I went to entertainmentcareers.net and there was a non-union scripted television show, which non-union scripted is not that common, but it was a scripted show for MTV and it was with puppets. It was a spinoff of this old Fox show called Greg the Bunny. It was a show called War on the Ape. And again, for as rare as a scripted show that makes its way to a online website that posts, you know, looking for a job, I got the job and that was my first scripted gig. And it eventually went union when the show flipped union. So it was also my first union job.
Okay.
And then, you know, but then I had to kind of deal with a sobering reality, because, you know, I said, I'm in scripted now. I'm never going to work reality again. I'm in union now. I'm never going to work non-union again. Right. And from that, I kind of learned that, you know, your first union show will probably not be followed by your second union show. And your first scripted show, at least if you're doing this path, you know, that I did, might not be followed by your second scripted show, because it wasn't for me. But, you know, and I was a little, you know, I was disappointed at first, but, you know, kind of ping ponged back and forth until I met enough people to go, oh, cool, I got another scripted show. So fast forward, you know, I kind of did that, went back to reality for a little while. And then I had a friend who I just met via Facebook. So I was really into the Facebook forums, avid editors of Facebook, and, you know, a few others, and just kind of like, you know, was meeting people and, you know, you become Facebook friends, the kind of people you've never like seen them in person, but you're like, oh, you're cool, I respect you.
Yeah.
And so I was working on a show and then somebody just reached out and said, hey, you sound like you know what you're talking about. I'm working on this show. And it was a scripted show that was kind of masquerading as a reality show, this show called The Real Husbands of Hollywood.
Oh, and I know that one.
The Kevin Hart show. And so it was kind of handy because it's like, you know, where you kind of go, oh, I do scripted, it doesn't translate, or I do unscripted, it doesn't translate to scripted. It's like, well, no, when you like a show like that, that kind of blends both of those worlds, opportunity arises. And so I did that and kind of after that, it was a matter of, okay, I'm going to talk to these people, I'm going to maintain these relationships, and then it kind of snowballed, you know. And so that was my jump into scripted television. I started working pretty consistently in scripted television, but kind of like what you were talking about, you know, meeting Lawrence and all that, you know, then, you know, you have the division of like the. It's so difficult because the world of editing can be very insular. And so if you're working in promo and trailers, people tend to be a little closed off to the idea that you can do long form.
Right.
And okay. If you're in reality, people can be very closed off to the idea that you can do scripted. And likewise within television to features, you know, there's often the stereotype that, you know, feature editors can't do television because they're too slow, and television can't do feature films because it's just a different beast. And, you know, it's, you know, those are all of these stereotypes that I think are a little silly. You know, are there differences? 100% there are. Yeah. They're just not that crazy. And I also think it was also different at a time when television only meant network television, because the idea of doing a show and hitting really hard commercial break, you know, points, that's a very tricky thing, which if you're not used to. Yeah. But yeah. Now in the era of streaming, where that goes right out the window, yeah. It's cutting for streaming television is a lot more like cutting features. So we are seeing like a blend of that. That's not to say that streaming shows sometimes don't need to conform to certain norms for television in case they get sold later. Mm-hmm. But all that to say, there are differences, but they're just not that crazy, you know?
Yeah.
There is truth to the notion that, you know, as an editor, you might not get it, mm-hmm. but that's no, like to say that would be a boundary by genre is no different than, I mean, we've all read books that we just don't connect with, you know, you don't empathize with the character and someone else loves it and does. And so, you know, if you're working on a story that you simply can't connect with it, if you've done, I mean, that's not to say that you can't have edited 20, 30 films and be a well-seasoned editor, and you just get that story that you just go, I can't connect with this. And if you can't connect with it, it's going to be hard to tell that story. And then to say that because you cut, you know, long form, that you can't cut a snappy promo because you're just not going to get it. It's like, no, you're going to have, I think there's something to be said about, you know, there might be certain projects that you're just going to connect with more or less than others, but just to say like uniformly by genre, by nature of you haven't done it, so you will never get it. That's silly.
Yeah. I suppose, let me quickly just jump back a bit. At what point did you go from say like Final Cut, Premiere Pro into your first time with Avid?
I think about that job a lot. And in retrospect, I sometimes wonder how I didn't get fired and if I should have been fired. Okay. Only because so I had practiced on Avid. I got really lucky, and on Craigslist I found somebody who was selling, at the time it was the Avid Mojo, and a copy of Avid Express Pro, right. Which is sort of like a watered down version of Media Composer, and they were selling it dirt cheap, and I was just like, awesome, I can learn Avid. But just because you learned Avid doesn't mean you really know how to use it with its peculiarities on an actual show.
Right.
So my first jump from Final Cut Pro to Avid was on a reality show pilot, and I was so nervous, and I wanted to do well, but you know, for example, grouping clips in Final Cut is a very different beast from grouping clips in Avid, in particular because Final Cut doesn't have, or didn't have, an equivalent of multi-grouping that Avid is famous for, which is why Avid was so good for reality. You know, it was a way of, you could take an entire day's worth of footage, and it's kind of like a string out of groups, you know, where it's like one group, and when a camera angle drops out, you can drop another one in. It took a lot of know-how and there was a lot of, you know, steps to make it work properly, but you could do it in Avid. I had no idea what that meant. Mm-hmm. And so I was grouping these clips, and, you know, my post supervisor was, I remember at one point he came in and said, "You don't like grouping, do you?" And I was too nervous to say, I didn't entirely even know what the term meant, but you know, I stuck with it. And there was a night assistant editor who was coming in who was far more experienced than me. And so, you know, it was kind of one of those things where in retrospect, I probably should have been the night guy. He should have been the day guy, but I would just ask him as much as I could. And, you know, just looking up as much as I could, just kind of, you know, learn what I needed to do. So all that to say, it was a terrifying experience. And I was definitely a fish out of water. I can't honestly say I even think I was totally qualified for it. But I think there's also something to be said about taking something from that, which is, you know, when you're ready to make a career advancement, not to be overly hung up on this idea of, am I ready? Because when you take a step up, are you ever truly ready? And that's not to say that you should jump into something completely blind, because you need to have some preparation, but the jump is going to be scary any way you look at it. And so don't be paralyzed by that.
Yeah. You know, I think you're right there. I think, like you say, otherwise you're never going to learn anything new. You're just going to constantly kind of stay at a certain level.
And you know, if you're comfortable all the time, you know, I mean, who doesn't like being comfortable? But you go, I want to do something new. I want to do something different. You're like, okay, it's going to be really scary, but you know, but if you stick with it, you know, there's something to be said about, you know, like you go, you know, I mean, I've had those jobs where you just have that stress in the pit of your stomach and everything about it says like, I need to quit and save face. And I've never done that. But you know, the thought has crossed my mind, and it's like, I think people are generally, you know, reasonable, but there's something, you know, to be said, if you need help, reach out for it. And having a network of people, you know, it's so easy now via social media, like that you can reach out to people like, hey, I'm having this problem. Does anyone know? And, you know, with groups like Avid Editors of Facebook and other groups, like so many people are so generous with their time, you know?
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that. There's so many forums out there as well, where you, even a Google search will give you an answer from someone who's put it out there already. So
that's the other thing, is like it's so funny how, like, especially with the Avid forums, which, you know, if you ever go to the Avid is it L2s, I think, like you look at these forums and they are very antiquated looking, I mean, but the odds are overwhelming that if you have a problem, someone has had the same problem before you. And Google search is your ally.
Yeah, there's a lot to be said with programming and editing, where there's the same kind of thing where whether you know it or not, it doesn't really matter. If you know the foundations of something, you can kind of work out the kinks. I think the timing will have been different as well in terms of when you jumped into the job as to now, where there's some information out here to this day, where someone being in the same position as you now, back then, it would almost be a little bit easier if they know how to, you know, navigate through a general editing process along with you know, non-linear editing setup as well. So I think it does say something to your character though, in terms of that even when it has gotten tough or you didn't know what you were doing, how you still figured it out, you still pushed through, you still kind of had that tenacity to make sure that you finished the job, and that again kind of shows where you are now because of that process, that those trials and tribulations that you've gone through. So that's a big thing there.
And you know, I think it's worth noting too, because, you know, imposter syndrome is one of those things, you know, I will not pretend that does not run deep in me. In fact, I cannot think of any job recently where I have not gone into it. And, you know, I feel like, you know, you have the interview process, it goes great, you start the job, you're excited, your confidence is riding a high, I can do this. And like, I feel like, you know, you make a little mistake and it, you know, you start to dip and dip and dip. And then like, I kind of go like, this is the job when everyone's going to find out that I don't know what I'm talking about. And I think that's a normal thing. And especially as you start moving upward, you know, you get excited about projects and you work on projects that you care about really deeply. It's hard to not feel that. And so, you know, certainly I'd love to send my empathy to anyone who's feeling that, is It's totally normal. And quite honestly, I like to think of it as it's the price of integrity. You know, it's like if you don't care, then your mistakes might not bother you as much. And now I also want to address the double edge to that blade, which is don't let your mistakes weigh you down, which is advice that I need to be better about taking, you know, and forgiving yourself for your mistakes and moving on. Obviously, you make too many mistakes, you make too many of the same mistakes, that's going to be a problem. But actually, one of my favorite coworkers I've ever worked with, he was a co-producer on a show I worked on. He would always bring on the post PA, someone who was like eager to get into the field. And he would come into my room. We'd be talking about, oh, you know what we need to. This is what we need you to do on a daily basis. Blah, blah, blah. And he would always tell them, the difference between you and me is I've made more mistakes. And that's something I always try to be mindful of, is like mistakes are where you learn, you know. So, you know, and
I think that's where people freeze up in that worry of making a mistake constantly.
and nobody likes making mistakes, and nobody likes making mistakes when you then have, especially when you're working on a large team and everything has to be done in large email chains for visibility. And then after a large email chain, you have to respond to everybody to say, hey guys, I made a mistake, you know. But I think there's something to be said about if your response is, hey guys, I made a mistake, I fixed it, here's the fix, sorry about that, you know. Like, it's embarrassing. There's no way to not be embarrassed by it, but it is what it is, and you learned, and you move on, and it's totally okay. But the fear of making mistakes can paralyze you from making a choice, which can be far worse, you know. It's like, you know, so, like, being so afraid of making the wrong choice that you make no choice helps nobody, certainly anyone trying to move forward, you know.
You've gone through this process. You've learned Avid. You start to learn Avid. What was the next step for you in terms of like getting into the process of features scripted?
Well, you know, I'd hit a point where I was working pretty consistently in television, scripted television, but I still knew that, you know, the feature I wanted to do features, and it's just kind of a different world. And you know, like, folks who work features consistently tend to, you know, stay within those worlds, and they have those relationships, and I just wasn't making those relationships. So I hit a certain point where I was like, okay, I guess feature films is not in the cards for me. I'm never going to work in features, so I'm going to start making the distinct decision to go from an assistant editor in scripted to editing, you know. Because my thought was always that, you know, I felt that as an assistant editor, I could traverse the worlds easier than as an editor. I don't necessarily know whether that's true or not, but that's at least what my rationale was. I'll go from assistant editing in unscripted to assistant editing in scripted to assistant editing in features, and then move up.
I see.
But I just wasn't making those relationships, so I said, I'm going to start making distinct moves to edit in television. And as I was doing that, I just randomly got a call from somebody that I had met in a forum, you know, and they said, hey, this guy's looking for an assistant editor for this, you know, super low budget action film. And you know, and then I was like, okay, well, if I do that, you know, I'm going to back to assistant editing, and because it's a new world, it's, you know, features and not television, I'm going to have to spend a good amount of time, you know, really kind of proving myself before I start making that move up. And I wanted to do it, so I did it, you know. And I was working with this great editor, I love him to death, Peter Devaney. We did this action film called, it was at the time it was Favela, but I believe the title changed to Falcon Rising. And it was this action film with Michael Jai White, and it was a really fun film. It was my first feature, and Peter is absolutely hilarious. And the dynamic between Peter and the actor, or the director, Ernie Barbarish, they had such a fun relationship, and it was such a joy of a project. And the funny thing about it was, despite being like having this idea crammed in my head that it's all Avid, all of your films are going to be on Avid, we cut it on Final Cut, and we didn't even have a server. We had this one little like RAID drive. And so every day the hard drives would come in and I would just copy the footage onto, I had a little RAID tower and then Peter had a little RAID tower. And it was super, you know, it was very budget, low budget, and it was very, you know, lo-fi technologically. So I would get the hard drives. They were shooting in Puerto Rico and the hard drives would come in and I'd just drop it. We had like, it was those, it was an actual internal hard drive, but I just slotted into a little deck, you know, and then I'd bring it into my tower, organize everything. And then when we'd go to lunch, I would plug that into Peter's system. And then I'd copy it over while we were at lunch. That way, when we'd come back, all the footage would be copied and then I'd hand them over a project with the media. And because it was Final Cut, you know, there's a lot of accommodations you had to make, because that's the thing with Avid is it's at the time it was Unity, then it became ISIS and Nexus, you know, the bin sharing process was just so much more elegant than what you had to do with Final Cut. So we'd have to do, you know, just some workarounds, you know, but it would usually be, we'd have one project dedicated to incoming media and then he'd have his own project dedicated to his sequences. And so I'd copy that over. And, you know, but the lessons learned with the trials and tribulations of both Final Cut and a lot of the tricks that I had to use in reality really came back to help me in that process. And so that was my first step into features. And and then actually, which, you know, kind of contradicts my last rule, which was, you know, second job won't be followed, your first job won't be followed by your second. By random dumb luck, Larry had heard of me from somebody else and reached out and said, hey, I'm doing another low budget, you know, another film, if you're interested. And it was, you know, the tricky thing about it was, it was way low budget. In fact, it was kind of one of those things where I kind of had to look at, you know, the pay hit I was going to take in order to take the job. Right. But then I looked at the film and I was like, oh, this really looks pretty amazing. And so it was this low budget film called Flock of Dudes with comedians that would, you couldn't even get them in the same room nowadays. You know, at the time, you know, it was Kumail Nanjiani as he was still coming up. It was Eric Andre, Brett Gelman, Chris D'Elia, and I mean, like these huge comedians. And it was, you know, it was kind of like, oh, cool, I'll do this, you know. And it was a great film. It was a blast to be a part of.
Yeah.
And same thing, working with Larry. It was, you know, that was my first feature on Avid. So now that was a different beast, you know. Okay, I've done it once on Final Cut. Now we're doing it on Avid, and that was about an 8-month job. And again, it was a weird situation where it was very lo-fi. We didn't have a shared storage. So Larry had his own storage set up and I had my own tower. So I'd bring everything in and then I'd organize it. And then we'd go to lunch and I'd copy it over. So it was like, okay, you know, this, like, I think there's something to be said about, you know, sometimes when I would be learning the process, I'd be like, I'm not learning it the right way, 'cause I'm not learning it with the technology and all this stuff. And it's like, yes, there is value in learning how, you know, the big dogs do it, but also you might not always have all those resources. So also knowing how you can, you know, how you can figure it, other ways of doing the same task are really valuable. So that was kind of the long story of my first two films, which was really my start into that world, you know. And, you know, as time went on, you know, I later worked with Larry on a film called Naked, Netflix, and that was kind of like our first, you know, that was my first experience working as an assistant editor where I had a second, you know. And that was a new beast, in that it's one thing when you're a solo assistant editor and you're doing everything yourself and the editor comes to you only, and then like I was like, oh, I have to like delegate tasks. That's weird. And honestly, it was really hard to relinquish work that I would traditionally do. But as you get onto bigger projects, you just realistically can't do everything, you know? And you start realizing certain things. I was like, oh gosh, I'm kind of a control freak, aren't I? You know? And also, you know, the coming to a state of Zen where you ask for things to be done a certain way and maybe they will be, and maybe they won't be. And then it kind of comes down to going, Okay, this isn't exactly how I envisioned it, but in principle, it does what I needed to do, so that's okay. Or, going, I needed it done this way, and you didn't do it this way, so I really need you to do it this way, and being an effective leader in a way that, you want to encourage your team and not, diminish their confidence. And, it's it that that was a major lesson for me, a major, quite honestly, a growing pain for me. But I had a our second assistant on that film was wonderful, and it all worked out great with that.
How was that process for you? Is that something that you feel comfortable with? Like was it like a straightforward, it was a growing pain, you said. So in what sense was it, from more of the control aspect or more of how do I kind of keep people upbeat and energized, and how was that for you?
It was difficult for me because there is a you know th there is there's always that sense of I get very nitpicky about things. I like things the way I like them, and so it is something to learn to learn within yourself, what is different but totally fine, and what is different and needs addressing, and then addressing problems, and like addressing an issue without being confrontational is difficult if you haven't done a lot of it, and and also adapting to how people receive the way you criticize their work, because I mean, criticism is just the nature of the beast, but there's something to be said about doing it in a way that again encourages a good result and good work, and not in a this doesn't work, this is terrible, does it? And I've certainly experienced both ends of that. Just the kind of people that destroy your confidence and tear you down, and and the people who are just like very encouraging and like, okay, this I see what you did here, and and I see why you did that. That's not the way we need it. So do it this way, this way, this way, and that's certainly what I strive to be. But again, it was a very sobering moment to kind of go like, oh, Richard, you might be harping on things that aren't necessary, and so, and part of that is, the dynamic of the first assistant editor is, as the first, I'm answering directly to my editor, and different teams tend to be different. I've worked with some teams where you are the first is very much the conduit to the editor, and there's not a lot of dialogue with the seconds directly. And fortunately, most people I've worked with are a little bit more personable than that. But if it is a very distinct delineation, that is the dynamic of the cutting room. And I found though, as a first, I am I am the direct voice to the editor, and if something that I've delineated to someone else gets done in a way that the editor doesn't like, that's on me. And some people would treat that differently, but then you kind of acknowledging where, okay, maybe I need to double check these things more, maybe I need to and it's the dynamic between trusting and but also being just doing a quick once over, because obviously I don't want to nitpick people who are working under me, and I don't want to convey this sense of like I can't trust you because I have to check every little, because you'll never get the work done if you're doing it essentially twice every time, so making sure that the work is being done properly, but managing people and personalities, and again, like some people are more sensitive to how you approach them, and some people take it for what it is, and so I think there's also something to be said about when I need to soften the blow, and how I approach that, is a tricky thing, There's a quote that and I can't remember who specifically said it, but it was that editing is a creative craft and it's not technical. And it's a quote that I think about a lot because I disagree with it actually. I actually think that editing, is three-pronged. I think it's creative, technical, and interpersonal. And I think all of those are critical. Obviously at its core, it's a creative craft. It's about storytelling. That is the bottom line. But I feel like in this era of technology, that technology informs the creative in the sense that, as new versions of the software comes out and new techniques come out, decisions that might have previously been impossible or prohibitively expensive might be totally reasonable. I mean, you look at something like split screen effects, in the film days, that would be, you'd have to cut two frames and match them up together. And depending on how much one camera was moving versus the other, it might either be simply impossible, it might look absolutely horrible, or it might just simply be incredibly expensive. Now, split screens are as ubiquitous as dissolves. They are everywhere, just making two performances to come together more quickly. And the other thing is just interpersonal, is it's one of those things where you can be the best editor in the world, but if the slightest criticism of your work causes you to fly off the handle, you're never going to get anything done. And there's something to be said about, fighting for your vision, but also kind of recognizing when, maybe this isn't my battle to be fought. Maybe I need a, because it is, everyone has a different perspective, and we're all trying to pursue this end result, and so I do think, sometimes that there it's really important to not write off everybody in the process. And it become it becomes easy to just say, oh, so and so doesn't know what they're talking about. And I it's a very humbling moment too, when both as in the I haven't edited quite as much as I've assistant edited and VFX edited, but as an editor, when someone gives you a suggestion, you say, that's never going to work, and you try it and you go, yeah, that worked pretty well. And same thing when I find as a VFX editor now, which I primarily work as of late, when someone says, Richard, I need you to do this effect, and you go, that's never gonna, those plates don't work together, that's never going to work. And the old me would have just said that. And I tried to be cognizant of that and go, before I say that, let me just give it a try. And sometimes you give it a try and you go, I was right. It's just not gonna, it's the plates don't support that. It's not gonna work. And sometimes you sit down with it and you go, oh, this is gonna work. And maybe it's something where I can't make it work in the Avid, but I can make it work enough to go, we can give this to a vendor that, yeah, this is, that's totally going to work. And so, there's this sense of, like, no bad ideas, just giving things a try. And again, if there is a totem pole, whether you're your assistant editor to your editor, or your editor to your director, to your producer, there is a certain totem pole to things. And there's a time when, one has to kind of go, okay, I've said what I needed to say, and I have advocated for what I wanted to. Okay, that's what we're doing. And that's there, it's one of those things where when you lose a battle like that, there's nothing to like about it, but it's just gonna happen.
How did the leap into VFX happen for you?
So that grew largely out of assistant editing. Really, Naked was kind of the start of it. Naked was right around the time when I started making that transition into projects that had more and more visual effects. On Naked, we had about 200 and something visual effects. It was enough for me to handle as an assistant editor, but it was certainly enough that I was like, it's like, this is getting to be a lot. And I think that can be a difficult thing too, because I've worked some projects where they'd be like, I did work on a project where they were very adamant, no visual effects. And I was like, so 100, 150 is like, there's no non-visual effects projects. Like, even if you have like facial fixes, vanity fixes or split screens, is like, you're still gonna have stuff. And so working on Naked, we had stuff from like split screens and very simple effects, but tracking all of those was like, oh, I actually really like this. And like I built a database in order to keep track of that and keep track of incoming versions and notes and reviews. And so out of that, I was like, I really enjoy that process. And I started talking to VFX editors, because it was one of those things where, like, I was like, what is a VFX editor? And, you know, there was a sense of, am I going to need to learn Nuke? Am I going to need to learn After Effects? And as I talked to more and more folks, it was like, oh, it's really, you know, about tracking the shot, tracking the changes, and then getting those elements out to the vendors, you know, and, you know, doing composites, you know, certainly composites to sell the shot, to make sure it's going to work. That's a part of it, you know, post-viz. And sometimes, you know, you need to get things nice and you'll use After Effects. I don't use Nuke. I know some that do. It's always felt a little intimidating to me, and I should probably learn sometime, but, you know, but all that to say, you know, I was like, I really enjoyed the databasing and the tracking and the comp work. And so that was when I realized that really, it's, you know, it's a phrase that can kind of mean different things in different situations, because I've known some VFX editors who have just straight up been given sequences. If it's a sequence with just a ton of blue screen or green screen, and it's going to require so much comping kind of on the fly, I've known some VFX editors who are kind of given the autonomy to really go with it and go, put this scene together and see what you can do with it, because, you know, because the editor's worried about other scenes and they're gonna have to do so much on the fly comping. Some editors are great at doing their own comps, some others want to hand those off to the assistant editor and to the VFX editor, and so you might have the autonomy to actually cut a scene. And it might be more of a position where it's more like a highly specialized assistant editor, where you're tracking the changes and turning over those plates to the vendors. And so that was kind of, you know, getting interested in it on a small scale in Naked was kind of the start of that. And then, you know, my first job as a VFX editor was on a series called Catch 22. It was this Hulu show based on the book. And that was kind of like my, okay, let's see if I can do this. And kind of like we talked about earlier, it was this whole like, oh, this is scary, you know, especially since there's a lot of terminology that people were throwing at me that I'd never heard before. And there's always the conflict when someone uses a term that you don't know. Do you say yes and then see if you can look it up and find out what it is? Or do you go, what is that? You know, and it also goes back to the whole not wanting to make a mistake, you know, kind of thing. And I'm kind of at a point where nowadays I'm a little more comfortable kind of raising my hand and going, what is that? You know,
yeah,
just because I'd rather be crystal clear on what I'm being asked than move forward and deliver something that is wrong that could have been answered with the question. And with that comes the need to also read the room and go, am I working with supportive people who are not going to treat me like a fool for asking that question? Or am I working with people who will? Because if that's the case, okay, then you might want to be judicious. And it's unfortunate that you have to deal with that, but people like that exist, and it simply is what it is. But, you know, I remember on that project, like they were, since I was doing small stuff on Naked, they were hitting me like, I want to be getting V0s in real quick. And I was like, what is a V0? You know, which I didn't realize that's a thing with visual effects, where when you turn over a plate before they do any work with it, they deliver a version zero, which is just their way of going, this is the plate as is. Let's make sure that the color looks correct, because the visual effects house has to take the LUT and the CDL and all the color information that you've gotten from your dailies. At the very least, that needs to match. Yeah. And sometimes if it's a plate that has a speed change or like a simple split screen, before they do things like adding CG elements to it, they're going to make sure that that base plate is accurate. Okay, here's it with the speed change and with a simple split screen. We'll refine the split later, so don't give us notes on that, you know. And then you go, okay, that's good. Mm-hmm. You know, I had no idea what that meant. So you're like, okay, it's scary. But again, fortunately, the people I was working with were just awesome, friendly, wonderful people.
Maybe we could jump into that area, like what how you worked or what you did on She-Hulk and other film shows and programs that you've done as well.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. Since you mentioned Bill and Ted, that also touches upon something I wanted to mention, you know, also with the whole After Effects versus Nuke and whatnot, you know, when it comes to, you know, temp compositing, because as a VFX editor, most of the work we're doing is temp. I've certainly worked on some shows, you know, it happens a little bit more in TV when you're just dead under an air date, you know, where it's like, this has to go to air. And so you're like, okay, gotta really do this nice. And if that's the case, I'll often bring it into After Effects, or if it is something that I can just really refine in the Avid. But the one thing I certainly want to impress upon people who are interested in going into VFX editorial is, and this is just my opinion, I don't say this as objective truth, but I'm of the opinion that it is far more important to do as many comps in the Avid as you possibly can. And the reason for that is when you do a comp in the Avid, you're giving the editor the flexibility to open the shot, especially in the early stages of the cut where the cuts really might be changing a lot. And if you can do your work in the Avid, you're giving your editor a lot of flexibility, because the minute you bring something into After Effects, one of two things can happen. The first thing is you'll pull your shot. I always treat my After Effects comps like I would a traditional vendor. I'll pull it with 8-frame handles, you know, or maybe a little bit more if I think I need that. But you pull it with handles. But then if your editor opens it up, well, then you need to bring that back into After Effects. You need to pull it back out. And right. if it's the kind of situation where your editor has a screening in 20 minutes and they go, hey, Richard, I opened this shot up by 30 frames. Can you just, and you know, you go, well, I'm going to kick that out, bring it in, pull it out. Pull it back, you go, that's never going to make the screening in 20 minutes. But if it's something that I've done in the Avid and they hit me real quick and say, hey, Richard, I opened this up and it kind of screwed up the tracking. Can you fix it real quick? I'll be like, I think I can do that. So you just, you know, there's a lot of advantage to that. But that said, there is a time and place. You just need After Effects. But, you know, but all that to say, you know, as far as being good at art, you know, as a kid, I drew a lot. So I always loved that aspect of it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, comping wise, you know, I would go to videocopilot.net, and that's how I learned After Effects. Yeah. And that's website for anyone who's trying to learn After Effects. That was how I learned After Effects. It's awesome. Yeah. And so, you know, I just kind of learned the tool set there. And, you know, you kind of, I think with doing visual effects and compositing, you really learn by doing and kind of learning what makes a good blend. And there's like little tricks that help fool the eye, you know, like little things like, you know, I always found it funny, like the idea of adding noise to a shot always seemed like, why would you ever do that? And then I would learn little things like, if you're taking like a freeze frame element of like the corner of the frame and you're tracking it, you go, well, yeah, but then the rest of your shot has, you know, film, you know, video noise, or if you're shooting on film grain, and then you have the section that has nothing and you go, oh, you add that and it blends it, you know. Mm-hmm. Little things like that are not super obvious, you just learn by practicing. How do I make the seams go away? You know, feather the edges and motion track it, or like, you know, you're doing something like a split screen, but it's a handheld shot. So you go, oh, I need to stabilize this shot, motion track it to this one, and that's how I'm going to make that look natural. You know, so it's like, you know, it's a lot of steps before you get to the end result, but you know, that was that for me was just a matter of practice. And on Bill and Ted, that was a show that was very personal to me. I was a big fan of the movies as a kid. I was over the moon when that happened. And that was, you know, we had the big, there's a big sequence in hell and a big sequence in the future. And those were just all green screens. And so that was just, you know, just bucking down. And you know, they were tricky too, because there was a lot of smoke effects for diffusion, and so, you know, trying to key those nicely. And again, you have to kind of draw a line where if you're doing it for temp, making sure you're not wasting too much time, because if you're doing these comps, I mean, I could spend an hour or several hours on one shot, but you go, if I do that, I'm never going to get through these shots. So at a certain point, you just need to get the point across, hand it to the editor and go, are we telling the story? Great. If I show this to an audience, to a layperson, you know, for friends and family, a test screen, are they going to be pulled out of the film by looking at this? No. Okay, cool. Great. Move on. Yeah. You know, like I try to limit my temp comping to, you know, 15, 20 minutes, you know, more than that, you go, okay, is it worth it? You know, and on some shows, you might actually be sending temp comps out to an actual vendor to do, because you might not have time, or it just might be the kind of temp comp that, even though it is temp, it just might be out of your ability to do. Mm-hmm. You know, your comping is short for compositing.
Okay.
And so, you know, and there's a variety of techniques to do that, and different kinds of compositing. You know, for example, a split screen, you know, if you wanted to cut out my shoulder here and then, you know, put this half of the room because maybe someone walks by and you need to do that. Or, you know, or if you have two performances and two people are talking and they take a long pause and you want to move up time, you'll split, you know, you just do a little cut and move them together. You know, that tends to be a very common composite. And it's always funny because with compositing, it's always the little things that make it hard. It's never the big things. Okay. Nearly ever. You know, you go, okay, I'm gonna cut one person out of the frame and I'm gonna cut another person out of the frame and then I'm gonna move them together in one shot. And then you go, yeah, but then on the left side of the frame, a bird flies through and it doesn't fly through the right side. So now how do I make that work? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, you have something going on in the background or one of the cameras was maybe slightly shifted from the other. So you go, oh God, how do I do that? Or, you know, the other example is you have two handheld shots. So you go, well, if they're handheld, they're both moving at different intervals. So how do I make them work? And, you know, the trick is you stabilize one so it's not moving, then you cut it out, then you motion track that back to the other one so it inherits the motion of that shot. And then you have a shot that works, you know, and that's then hopefully you don't have a bird that flies through or something like that, you know, those little things. And those are also the kinds of things where you go, you know, in terms of managing your own time, you can then say, okay, this is something that I can't fix in the Avid. Yes, there's a bird. And once it goes past my head, it doesn't come through the second half of the frame. We'll hand that to the vendor and we'll give them a clean plate and they can do a better job with the better tools they have, you know.
I see.
And if it's something that is just that egregious, okay, maybe you do have to painfully cut it out or do something like that. And though, you know, but you know, there's a little bit more of a time management aspect to the kind of comping that we do in the Avid. There is a, you know, is it telling the story and is it going to pull an audience out of the cut? And, you know, and then if you're good there, then you can move on to the next one. Because the thing is, you know, especially when you know, you're always, there's always the need to get the cut as filled out as possible. And on Bill and Ted, I got to a point where I was able to do like 30 to 35 comps a day, which was pretty good. Again, these are nothing that's going to win me an award. It's just, you know, I'm getting the blue screen out, I'm putting them in a different world, throwing just a still frame image of something that looks like, you know, the future, and great, hand it to the editor. Does this work? Cool. And, you know, the editor might just say, hey, I need the building here, can you do this? Yeah, cool, let me just tweak that, boom 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 boom, we have a set look and I can just jam and get these out, you know. And then once they'll start going out to the vendor, you know, there's a lot of different ways shots might make their way back into editorial. And it usually varies by team. Bill and Ted, our team was fairly small. So what would usually happen is I would get the shots and just present them straight to the editor, unless there was some egregious technical flaw. Yeah. So, you know, when you're working on a larger team where you might have, you know, a series of VFX supervisors and coordinators and producers, they're going to look at the shots and they might not even pass them to us, the VFX editors, to give to the editor. They might find that these shots are creatively so incongruent with where they're going that they won't even give them to us. And so, okay. And they might ask me to import them in the Avid. So if they need to look at them later, they will, but they'll say, don't pass these to the editors. Or maybe there's a note the editor gave me to pass on to the vendor and I get the shot back and then I have to tell the VFX supervisors or in the coordinators, hey, the editor asked for this thing. This isn't there. And sometimes it's a case of, yes, we know they did this before that note got into the process. It's going to come in the next version. Or it might be a situation of, oh gosh, yeah, they didn't do that. Okay, kick it back. We have to wait until this is, you know, because there is the need to make sure that communication is flowing. And quite honestly, that you're also giving the editor confidence that, you know, the team is, vendors are understanding what is being asked too. You know, it can be a difficult political game when it's like, if I give this to the editor and they just gave me that note and we're still not getting these, I've gotten several versions and they've asked for this, guys, are we understanding what we need here? And also So, I mean, it's also important to acknowledge sometimes in the process, there are certain types of comps that simply won't be done until the end. Like maybe it'll be like, hey, you need to fix this. You know, like the most common thing is vanity fixes tend to be done, you know, later in the process. So, right. Oh, they had bags under their eyes for the whole shot. So, you know, they go, we'll fix that. We need to get, you know, if there's like a CG character insertion, let's get that first done, you know, and then, you know, those are the kind of things where you go, okay, that the beauty fixes are going to be done later. That's fine. But,
yeah,
you know, and so in a large team, there might be a filtration process or a gatekeeping, if you will. And sometimes there is no gatekeeping and we'll just push everything on through. And, you know, there can be value to that. The editors are seeing things more, you know, with each iteration. You know, again, there can be good and bad to that, because I certainly don't want to freak anybody out and think like, hey, no one's not understanding. No, they got the note. It's okay. You know, and on a smaller team where you don't have that kind of filtration, use the VFX editor might be that kind of first and only point, you know, where you go, okay, I got these shots in. And those are the situations where then I kind of need to kind of play the judicious game where I might not show the shot to the director yet. I might want to get the editor's take on it first and go, do you think we should present this? Because I don't want to freak the director out and think, you know, if they're just not getting it. Because sometimes we need to kind of be that buffer zone of, let me send this back one more time and say, guys, the directors asked for it this way. And I don't think they're gonna be happy with this. And I think we'll keep things running a little bit more smoothly if we do it this, you know, mm-hmm. this way. And so, you know, we're making sure that again, everyone that people are their notes and their, you know, their suggestions are being implemented. And so and Bill and Ted was we had three or four main vendors and a few other small vendors, you know? And so it's tough with Bill and Ted, especially when you have entire environments. There's this great freedom you have with doing things digitally, but that kind of freedom is actually a really scary thing, you know? Yeah. It's kind of like, you know, when things are done entirely in camera, you're sort of locked to what you have, you know? And I love practical effects. But I also don't look at them with super rosy, you know, tinted glasses in the sense that, you know, when it's all in camera, that's it. That's what you got. Yeah. And, you know, sometimes you simply have to accept that. And there is often a charm that comes with that. And it's undeniable that looking at something tangible that's there gives the actor something better to react with, for sure. But, you know, there's also something to be said about, you know, with the digital environment, there's just the freedom to like, I wish that thing was a little bit over here. Well, that's going to cost time and they're going to have to re-render. But yeah, you can move the stalagmite over here, you know, and, you know, so I actually think that's a cool thing. You know, it can lead you down paths, you know, where you start going, is the brick being here versus there going to make or break the shot, you know, and those discussions certainly happen. But, you know, with the scale of what we were doing with Bill and Ted with full CG environments was a new thing for me. So like kind of trying to retrain my eye, not just to what I thought was what I should be paying attention to, but also to what the VFX supervisor and what the director is really paying attention to. So you kind of like lock onto, you know, you go, I noticed that the director tends to be really sensitive to this kind of thing. Oh, you know, there's if, you know, really, really intense reds and this kind of, he doesn't like that. So when I start getting shots that start showing those kind of things, I try to kind of be flagging those to our supervisor and to the vendors, you know, like, hey, we're getting a lot of these things, you know, they tend to be very particular about those things. So let's avoid those, you know? And right. So you're trying to lock on to different sensibilities.
You've gone from having a background and a scene to blue or you know, that's it. And then comes the, how do you put this together? Like, how do you start to use your imagination? How, like you said, how was that for you? What process did you have to go through with that?
You know, it was quite honestly, there was a lot of really, It really came out of watching how other people look at shots and look at the things they look at. One of the biggest examples I always think about and has always stuck with me is we had this shot. It was in the future, and they arrive at the future, and we kept on getting notes about the sky. The sky didn't look natural. And I remember I was just like, I know, I agree with the note, and I can't put my finger on it. And what is it? And our VFX supervisor at one point said, blow out the sky. And everything about that said, why would I intentionally blow out a shot? That's, isn't that like, no, you want a shot balanced. And it's like, oh, well, that's, you think about like the way shots often are, you go, oh yeah, that's a fairly natural occurrence in a shot. You know, you're shooting people on the ground in the sky as it gets brighter, is blown out. And they did that, and it was like, the shot works. Wow. You know? And so it's like those kind of things was kind of were really critical for me in terms of going, these are the things that are going to make the shot blend better. These are the things that I need to be looking out for. You know, like you go, a perfectly balanced blue sky with you know, bright white clouds and deep blue, you know, tint across a ground that's lit. You know, you go, sure, that's beautiful compositionally, and that looks nice as a painting, but you go, when was the last time you shot a shot and it looked like that? So you go, sometimes it's like, it's one of those things is imperfection is kind of what makes things natural. And so there is a certain value in preventing shots from getting too perfect because then they start to look fake. You know, there's a term called the uncanny valley, which is, you know, a term that I'd only heard fairly recently, which is, you know, it's this graph about particularly computer generated imagery, but it really applies to, you know, anything, you know, that's manipulated, which is as you approach a realistic look, there's a brief moment where the human eye, or just, you know, the human brain stops being fooled when you get too close to reality. And until you get all the way to reality, it's not there. And it's a large reason as to why certain effects, like, you know, like the miniature effects that you used to see in the 80s, you know, I mean, you know, there's an effect there going on, and it's a stop motion. You know, I'm thinking of Ed 209 from RoboCop, you know, which is one of my favorite movies, and I love it. And you buy it. You're there, and you buy it. I mean, you know, it's like whether or not you know the specificity that it's a miniature or whatnot, you're like, okay, there's not really a giant robot shooting at a RoboCop, but you know, but you're there. But as you know, especially with CG, you know, where you can really blend things, you know, you get to a certain point where the brain kind of goes, something's weird about that. You go, why is it? And it tends to be, especially when you're talking about faces or textures, you know, is like, you know, like, why does that robot look so shiny? And you go, well, because there's no texture. Like you go, brushed chrome, brushed aluminum is going to have brush strokes, and maybe it has like a ding where something hit it. And you go, when it's just perfectly flat in one shade, it doesn't look real. Or if you're doing like skin or something, if you don't have, you know, like I smile and then you see the crow's eyes show up in my eyes, I go, well, that'd be cool if I didn't have them. But you know, like if
Life,
you,
yeah,
that
that's
that
beautiful.
that's what people look like, you know. And so that's one of those, like once I learned that term and what it meant, it's kind of one of those things where it's funny how there are so many things that just psychologically you know and you see, but maybe you can't put your finger on it. And then when a term is applied to it, there's more of a sense that, okay, now I know what to look for. And now I know how I can look to mitigate those, you know. And maybe, I mean, not necessarily something that I can do myself in the Avid, but something that, you know, if I'm in a note session and, you know, and I go, why is that not working? Oh, I bet it's this. What if you do that? Drop a texture or a something, you know?
How was we'll jump into some other projects of yours that you've worked on as well. So how was She-Hulk for you, and what was your role in She-Hulk?
Certainly, it was a larger show than anything I had done before. So, you know, learn with more people comes more need for communication. So that was a big, you know, a big, you know, point of growth, which was really, you know, that was really valuable. Because it is, there's something about when you are the, you know, the lone gun VFX editor, you have a lot of freedom in the sense of, you know, you're kind of building out the workflow and the process, how things come in, how things go out. And if you need to make a change to the process, it becomes really easy to implement that, you know? Mm-hmm. And so it's like, oh yeah, I used to send you, you know, this paperwork, but I'm going to tweak it this way just to kind of do it, you know, so that I can communicate X, Y, and Z information.
Yeah.
And you're sort of the only point of contact. So you tend to be very privy to, you know, all of these conversations. And, you know, when working with the bigger team, it becomes a little bit more, I find that, you know, especially things that would change the process are, okay, if someone says, hey, can you do this thing a little bit differently? It tends to be the kind of thing where you go, let me talk to the team because that will affect all of us. And, yeah. You know, I need to make sure we're all on the same page, you know? And so things like that were sort of the biggest changes for me on a project like that. It was always nice being the lone gun, you know, where I can just like, oh, I can tweak this and tweak that and send that out, you know, especially with things like the database. You know, I built my own VFX tracking database.
Yeah.
And it's so nice when you go like, oh, someone's asking for this thing, so I can do a tweak here and then change this, and I can, and then this stuff can go out. And on a project like that, when multiple people are accessing this thing, which is kind of the beating heart of information that is sent out to vendors, it's like, okay, don't go messing with stuff under the hood, because that could affect a lot of people that you might not even be aware yeah. of. And yeah. so, you know, there is, you know, working with a large team, there is more of a need to keep things very consistent. I would dare say there is a rigidity to it, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just, you know, there are a multitude of people doing the same thing, and it's just kind of making sure that when you hand stuff off to vendors, when you hand stuff off to your different departments, that they know what to expect. You know, obviously, you know, by nature of being different people, there's always going to be a little bit of variance, but trying to keep that variance to a minimum so that at least the expectation when something arrives can be consistent. You know, okay, yeah. they sent me this, so this is what I'm expecting. You know, they sent me a bunch of polls, so this is what I can expect, and this is how I can expect to receive it.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
it's a very different beast on a large team. In some ways things become easier, and in some ways things become harder. You know, biggest thing is just communication. Communication is just paramount. And I find, especially on a large team like that, that's certainly the time when I side with asking questions to the point of annoyance, because I want people to know what I'm doing, when I'm doing it, and how I'm doing it before I start sending a bunch of things into motion that are going to trigger a lot of actions. And, you know, going, okay, well, at the very least, like, okay, so you want me to do this, this, this. Okay, I'm going to do this. Okay, cool. Oh, I ran into this complication. I'm going to do this, just so you're aware, you know, that yeah. way, in case someone says, oh no, don't do it that way, and this is why. Great, we're on the yeah. same page, because things do ripple out. And again, this goes back to our conversation about making mistakes. You're going to make mistakes, and you know, that's okay. But you know, certainly recognizing when you're a small part of a big process and how your actions will trigger a multitude of other actions, let's try to make sure before we trigger things in motion that everyone is aware of what we're doing, and that, you know, things are going to the right places, you know,
yeah.
that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, I tend to be, you become very verbose, and I go, I certainly hope I'm not being annoying. I just want everybody to be on the same page.
It's better to be annoying than completely slow a project down, or, you know, maybe mess something up or waste time when it could have been done a different way. So I think,
You know, and the thing too, to that point, is the thing that's always difficult about it is I've had situations where people have said, why didn't you ask me? And I was like, I didn't ask you because I thought I was doing it the right way. I legitimately thought I was doing it the right way. So, I mean, not to be sarcastic, why would I ask you if I truly thought I was doing it the right way.
Yeah.
And so so those situations arrive, and I've certainly done that where you've done something that might have been a ton of work and took you hours, and then you hand it over and you find out either you did way more work than you needed to, or you did it completely wrong and the whole thing has to be thrown away. And that is so disheartening. But it's like, okay, I did it wrong. I'm gonna write that down. I'm not going to do that again. And, you know, and it's like, you know, I mean, I have post-it notes all over my monitor. You make the mistake, put the post-it note there. And the good news is, you know, over time, it's going to become second nature and you're not going to need those. But certainly early on a project, you're probably going to need those reminders. And, you know, and especially, you know, the whole thing too is like, no two projects are exactly alike. So also there tends to be this sense of, you know, you may be the most experienced person in the world, but you're going to jump onto a new project and the process is going to be a little bit different based on either what people, you know, what kind of paperwork or communication people are expecting, or based on, you know, if you're not the lead, you know, your lead VFX editor is going to have, you know, they're setting the workflow and this is the way. So you go, okay, great. This is how I need to work. So you go, you're experienced, you're good. So don't lose sight of that, but go, okay, there's going to be a lot of things that I'm going to need to be aware of. And if it's not the kind of thing you're looking at every time, or if it's not in the place where you look for it every time, you know, you just kind of like, you lock onto like the ways that you can help yourself remember. And if, you know, for me, it's post-it notes all over, you know, or whether you write it down in a notebook that you reference every time, you know, and again, in time, it will become second nature and you won't be looking at that notebook anymore, because you'll just be like, I've already turned over 1,000 shots. What's another 50? I can do this, you know, so.
Yeah. What was your team, or what was your role in She-Hulk?
I was one of several VFX editors on that. So it was, that was what made made the experience so different than previous experiences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's just a large infrastructure. You know, you know what you're getting into with a project like that. And so, you know, it's one thing going from a project with, you know, several hundred to several thousand visual effects, and, you know, just different types of visual effects, you know. And so that was a new thing for me.
But you've done both universes now. You've done DC and you've done a Marvel, right? So you did Suicide Squad. You was involved in Suicide Squad.
Yes. Now, in fairness, it's funny, I always feel the need to not misrepresent myself, because I was on Suicide Squad for a very short amount of time. I was brought on by two wonderful people whom I love to death, Kim Boritz and Kevin Hickman, and they were working on that film. They needed someone to fill in for, I think it actually might have been just shy of a month. So I was not on that film for a very long time, but it was a project that I was super excited to be a part of, worked with very sweet people. And it is, you know, like that's a project that kind of it when you work on a project that you're well aware of, you know, that is well publicized and there's a lot of anticipation for, and that you were personally anticipating, because I most certainly was.
Yeah.
There is, and you know, Bill and Ted is another good example of that too, where it's like, there's actually a distinct danger of seeing how the sausage is made. And I find for me personally, there was like that sense of like, you go, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. Be professional. This is your job, you know? And so, I mean, and Bill and Ted was one of those too, you know, is like, you know, when we'd have ADR sessions and, you know, and I could be there and see Alex Winter and Keanu Reeves. And I'm like, and you go, this is the, don't you, you can't, I,
don't
I can't,
out. Don't be screaming.
I can't run up to you like a 14-year-old at a Backstreet Boys concert, even though I wanted to. I will admit, like, anytime I get to work on a studio lot, for me personally, that never gets old for me. I think there are pros and cons. You know, it's when you work at a little post facility, it's nice that you park at this parking lot and you have a 2-minute walk into your office and you're ready to go. And when you're on a lot, you might get to the studio lot and now you have a long walk to wherever your building is. But I don't know, like for me, I I mean, it's like, you know, that old image of like the guys moving the plate glass and the, you know, people walking around in costumes, or, you know, Pee-wee's Big Adventure when he's running around the Warner lot, you know, like I still do find that there is like the there's a magic in the air, and I love it.
Yeah,
Like,
I was
you're
gonna
like,
say that.
yeah. And you know, and you see like people getting the studio tour. I've actually been I once was going down, this was at Universal, and I was driving down the hill leaving work, and there was the tourist the studio tour, and people were taking pictures of my car. And I'm like, why do you want to take a picture of a cranky old assistant editor? You know?
That's brilliant. That's good.
But yeah, no, it's, you know, it's, but like I think that was a one of those projects where it's like, oh wow, this is wow, just okay, you know. And it's like it is one of those things where also I appreciated that on that project, just everyone was so nice. I have a theory, and there are exceptions to every rule, of course, but I have found that, you know, as you go on to bigger projects, you know, I find that people who feel the need to prove themselves less, you know, are like I really enjoy working with people who can just be pleasant like that. That's not to say that people can't be unpleasant, but you know, and I try to take that with me and encourage people to always just be, you know, just be kind, be cool, you know, because it's just like we're gonna be spending a lot of time with each other. And you know, you don't have to like everyone you work with. I certainly don't like everybody I've ever worked with, but you know, we can just kind of like, we're gonna be spending a lot of time together. So let's just, you know, just try to deal, you know. I've definitely like, and in a multitude of ways, you know, like, look, we all have our personalities. That's who we are as people. But you know, just I just find that, you know, and it's one of those things too, especially when you're getting involved in a new team. You know, I've worked with screamers, I've worked with, you know, with calm people, and I've definitely found too, in the early days of my career, I tolerated more abuse than really I probably should have. And I do think at this day and age, there is a major reckoning that is happening now. And I think that's a very good thing. You know, people are starting to learn that you can't get away with that anymore. And that's a good thing, you know. And I look back on that, you know, and look at, you know, some of the things I've had to endure and have been like, you know, it's like, yeah, I probably should have walked in a few of those moments, you know. I think, you know, the unfortunate truth to the field is it preys on ambition, it preys on passion, you know. And you know, the starry-eyed kid who, you know, steps off the, you know, the airplane at LAX and goes, I'm gonna work in movies. It's like that look in your eye can be exploited like that. And you know, I say that as an expression, but it is, I do think it's an important thing too, you know, like, you know, we've all endured it, but you know, also having respect for oneself, you know, is like, I have looked back on some situations where I have been like, I don't know if I should have accepted that, you know, and you know, dealt with that, you know.
No, you do make a good point there, which kind of does lead me on to the next two kind of questions, which is what would your advice to aspiring editors, VFX editors, or even assistant editors be getting into the industry, or something that you felt that has stuck with you? We've probably already discussed it through this interview, but what would be something that you would advise?
You know, the bottom line I always say is be kind and be curious. And be kind, it extends into a variety of arenas. The one thing that I think is so critical is social media. Social media is so valuable. I mean, I have a love-hate relationship with Facebook in that I think there is a world of ugliness that can be spread through it. And yet I've met a lot of wonderful people and have got a lot of answers to questions, and I enjoy sharing answers to other people's questions on it. There is this thing where I think people think in order to be taken seriously as a filmmaker, they have to badmouth other projects. And I'm always like, you know, you're not necessarily discerning or insightful because you can tear down a film. And I find for myself, you know, like if I love a film, I'll scream it from the rooftops. And sure, I'll go onto my social media and say, you gotta see this film. It's so good, you know?
Yeah.
And if I don't like it, maybe I'll just keep it to myself. And I think the reason for that, and if someone wants, if someone solicits my opinion, hey, what'd you think of this film? You know, I didn't like it for this reason. And I think part of it too is, I think the privilege of the layperson is the ability to say, this film stinks. I think the responsibility of a craftsperson is to support that opinion and say, I didn't like the film for this reason. Okay, I didn't like this moment. I thought this could have been better. I think if they would have added this, it could have helped enhance this aspect of the story. I think, you know, these kind of things, you know, because that's our job. Our job is telling stories. And so in order for me to be able to have an opinion on the footage that I'm editing with, you know, I need to be able to support that opinion and provide reasons for that opinion. And so when I'm watching a film too, like I always have this idea of like, I mean, is the whole film awful? The whole film's a wash. Nothing is good about it. I feel like most films I look at, you know, I go, there are overall, I didn't like it that much, but I did like these things about it. And I thought these things, you know, I questioned these areas about it. And I do genuinely think that is our responsibility of being a craftsperson in this field. And I don't think there are many bad films. There are a few. There are probably a few films that are just pretty darn terrible. But I think there's just so much more nuance to that. And so like when someone goes on, you know, just goes to these either going into a group or on your own personal page, this film is awful, it was stupid, what were they thinking? I go, first of all, you may not realize how close to the people who worked on that film you are, because you might be very close to them. And it would just never be worth it to have badmouthed that project and the person who edited it saw you say that. Mm. And then years down the line, you're interviewing for a project with them. And then they go, Richard, why do I remember that name? I know. You never want to be that person, because, you know, there's that old quote by Maya Angelou, and I think it is really pertinent, which is that people won't remember what you said or what you did, but they will always remember how you made them feel.
Yeah.
And I think that's critical, because again, it's one of those things is, should we not take criticism personally? Sure. Yeah. Because criticism is just, you know, the nature of the beast, but come on, if someone does something like that, you're going to remember it. And so I feel the need to be, just be, you know, you don't have to like any project, and if you want to criticize it negatively, do it constructively, do it with good reasons and support those reasons, and just don't be rude. It's never, and that's something that we are all individually in control of. So I do think that's something people need to be aware of, you know. Now that said, the flip side to that is also with social media, there presents a wonderful opportunity too, where, you know, if you see a project that you like, something that really affects you, it kind of provides an amazing avenue for people to go, you know, and I've done this before. Sometimes, you know, sometimes you get ignored and sometimes you get a response, but, you know, I've totally had the situation where I've watched a show, I've been like, that was a great episode. Who did that? I look them up on IMDb. This is the editor. I'm going to reach out to them and just say, hey, I saw that episode. That was awesome. Like, and I think there's a wonderful community building aspect to that, you know, and it's kind of one of those things where, you know, one, it's good to meet people. It's good to know people. And maybe you get a polite hello and that's the end of it. And hey, maybe you meet someone, you make a friend. And I think that's really, the community is really what it's all about, you know. Mm-hmm. But the one thing you're completely in control about is how you spew your opinion. And it's never, I would argue it's never worth it. You know, again, it's not, it's, you know, there's a time and place for candor, and yeah, maybe be cool about it.
it does tend to boil down to one, is it even your cup of tea? That kind of expression. Is it something that you even like? And then from there, maybe you don't like the idea, the way that the story ends, and that ruins the whole experience for you. But someone else might like it. So, you know, but no.
And also when criticizing editing too, there's something to be said about, like, you know, that was a bad edit or was edited badly. And I have a theory, which is completely untested, but my theory is that I wonder if perhaps the best edited film in existence is a film that is fairly lackluster in experience, but we'll never know that because someone had to spin magic out of something that completely didn't work. Yeah. And all that is to say that it's really hard, you know, especially as an editor, to say, you know, it was a badly edited moment, because not having seen the footage, you know, we've all been in that situation where you go, this is not working. I don't have what I need to get it done. And I feel like, you know, it generally boils down to three questions. You know, you go, okay, we don't have what we need. So we can either fix it with visual effects. That might be too expensive to even consider. We might reshoot it. Reshooting is always expensive. Or we just live with it. We just got to live with it. And, you know, it's always interesting to see an editor watch their own works, because I always feel like, I mean, it almost looks like a PTSD, you know, experience where they're just like, ugh. And it's interesting when you ask them after the fact, like, oh, I love that moment. Oh, we were looking for this and we didn't have it, so we did this. Oh, that's so fun. You know, as an outsider to the experience, you don't even know, and you might have loved that moment. And so, you know, it's really hard. It's hard to say, like, what made that editing great without having seen the footage. You know, it might, there's always something to be said about, you know, sometimes you have multiple editors on a project, and sometimes, you know, one person just can't crack this scene, and then another steps in and gives you a few suggestions and you go, oh my gosh, the whole thing worked. Yeah. Or the thing that I still think is, you know, to quote Bob Ross, you know, with happy accidents, I always love the notion that, you know, you're working on a scene and it's just not working. And then you scroll to, like, something in between takes, and maybe your actor is making a joke with the crew person for a quick second before the camera cut, and they laugh, and you go, oh my God, I'm going to take that laugh, put that there. That made the moment work. And those things exist all the time. And I think it's also easy to look at projects that you haven't worked on and go, I bet you they had everything they needed. They had all the footage and all the coverage and everything worked. And then, you know, you actually talk to them and I feel like you invariably find out more often than not, all those struggles are the same, you know, like, we did the best with what we could, you know, in hopefully the dominant experiences you had what you needed, or you were able to get it later. But there are always going to be those moments where you had to work with what you had. And so all that to say, you know, there's often more to the story than just what ends up on screen.
There's a fan for every film. You know, there's the cult followings for films that even the worst movies have been rated, that there's fans of those. They'll go to the cinema. They'll, you know, they'll go and they bond over those films. So yeah, I think you make a good point.
You know, the thing I say too, and I hope I'm not inadvertently denigrating films just by saying this phrase, but, you know, like, sometimes you want filet mignon and sometimes you want a Big Mac, you know, 100%. And there is room for all kinds of films. You know, some you want to watch that philosophical thing that you're going to sit with and think about for, you know, weeks, and then talk and have deep conversations. And sometimes you just want to watch stuff blow up.
Yeah. And no one wants to make a bad film. No one takes money and goes to make a bad film.
I think Walter Murch said that it was, you know, when you revisit a project or you revisit a film, you know, the experience feels different because you're different, which is exactly what you were just saying too. And there is something to be said about, you know, like, you know, a breakup movie might be really sappy when you are happily single or happily within a relationship. But if you're reeling from a bad breakup, that might actually be something that is, you know, that gives you comfort in that moment. And there's value to that, you know. And, you know, also, like, there's something too about, like, it's funny too. I feel like so many books instill that, the first time you watch a film is the most important time. And actually, I feel like lately I've become under the opinion that the second time is the most important, largely because oftentimes things that get revealed, once you kind of know where they're going and you revisit a second time, that's where you often find really great things planted in there. And I love those moments, especially with really skilled filmmakers, where you kind of see maybe things that seemed very innocuous at the time. And then you go, oh, he's doing the thing, you know, like the biggest, actually, I don't want to even spoil it. I was going to use an example from Breaking Bad. And, you know, for anyone who's even still seen Breaking Bad, there's just too much good to that, that I don't even want to spoil that, you know, but
yeah. Such a good show.
Yeah.
Amazing show. Well, what I'll jump into here, because you've kind of created this course and community for people who want to get into editing, which is Master the Workflow. And if you've still got the time, it'd be great to discuss how that came about, what it's about, and who it's for, and how it's going to help people.
So Master the Workflow came about when I was working on the film Netflix. I was working on the film Naked for Netflix with Larry Jordan. And actually the way it started was I was diving really deep into database building. I was building, you know, a VFX tracking database, a code book. And I kind of wanted to build it out into a commercial product. And I thought, like, oh, I'm going to standardize the VFX database, which in retrospect was a deeply naive stance. But I started doing it, and as I built it out, I wrote a manual so that people would understand what was automated, what wasn't, what worked, what didn't. And the manual was 16 pages and it was really hard to follow. So I was like, well, maybe I think I'm going to need to do a video lesson, maybe screen capture. Maybe that'll be a better way to do it. And at the time, Larry was about to jump onto another film that I couldn't follow him on because I was already booked on another project. And so, he was like, well, I need someone who kind of knows what you know. And he says, what if you did a video? What if you just taught the assistant editing job? Because it was one of those things where film schools will dive into editing and, you know, editing theory and what goes into a cut, you know, but, you know, your first step into the field is generally going to be as a post PA and then an assistant editor. And a lot of film schools don't really dive into that. So, you know, we just said, okay, well, let's dive into the dynamics of being an assistant editor. Let's teach them what you're doing on a daily basis. So your dailies come in and what are the things you're looking for? We're looking that the dailies are in sync, that the color is correct, that we have our slates and, you know, and if you don't have what you need, who do you talk to? You know, because when I first started doing them, I didn't know, oh, I should probably talk to the script supervisor, you know, little things like that. And so, you know, we built out the class because there are great courses on how to use Avid and how to do grouping and how to do comping and how to do all these things in Avid. But, you know, what does the assistant editor do?
Yeah.
And so, you know, we built out from there. So we kind of, what we did was we contacted a company that's a great company called editstock.com. And what they do is they provide scenes for people to cut, they can practice editing. You get footage from well-produced student films and you can cut this stuff because really the way to get good at editing is just to practice. And so we reached out to them. They gave us a bunch of footage that we could use so we could simulate the experience from day one to delivery, you know, because the difficult thing that often happens too is if you have the opportunity to shadow an assistant editor and learn what they do, if you shadow them during dailies, they'll be able to show you dailies. But then you go, well, I want to learn turnovers. Well, turnovers aren't going to happen for months. So, you know, maybe you can come back then. Or, you know, I want to learn how to do comping. I was like, we're in dailies. We are a long way from comping, you know. And so what we tried to do was simulate the experience from soup to nuts. Here's when the dailies come in. These are the things you check. Now, as we're going along, your editor is going to ask you to do this. This is what they mean when they ask for this, you know, and We go over the database and how we track visual effects, track changes. And then when we get to the end, we're turning over shots. Okay, so how do I turn this over to picture finishing? How do I turn this over to sound? And the big thing that was a mystery for me before I worked on Naked was change lists. I had no idea what a change list was. Right. And there wasn't a lot of really good documentation on what that is. And so, okay, how do I convey those changes to the vendors? Because invariably, you lock the cut, but the term we like to use is latched. You know, it's, you know, yeah, sure, you send it off and then they go, oh, we need to change this. Okay, so you got to get those out to all the departments. The other thing that came out of it was, I remember the first film I worked on, they asked me for a code book and I didn't even know what a code book was. And I found at the time a code book was something that there wasn't a lot of information online about it. Right. And so for those who don't know, you know, going back to the film days, it was literally you would get your film and you would run it through a coding machine. And it was, you would just write down in this notebook, your code book, you know, it was, you're writing down the film numbers and the length of each shot and what take goes to what, you know, so that when you get to the end and you need to hand this off to the negative cutter, they could track this information from the work print to the negative print. In a modern context, it's literally just a database of every single clip in the film, you know, right. And that way you can go, hey, what, do you remember scene 16, take B? Oh yeah, that was shot on day 17. That's here, you know, That's literally all it was. And so the course kind of follows all of that minutia, you know, through finishing. So the idea is to give you the experience of sitting behind my shoulder as we go from the filmmaking process from beginning to end. And that was what Master the Workflow has become. And we're trying to integrate new classes. We're working on a Premiere Pro class. The big thing we stress upon with the course is that it's not an Avid course. So, yeah. You know, we don't teach you how to use Avid, but it's taught on Avid. So the expectation is that you know Avid because that's the tool we're using. And so we're going to run through, this is how you deliver all these specific things using Avid. But we recognize that, you know, in principle, it's the same if you do it on Premiere, but every system is going to have its own peculiarities. So we are working on a version for that. And the code book has kind of become this, you know, living product that is like, you know, it evolves over time. So when we first released it, you know, it was version 2.3, I think, and now we're up to version 2.9. Okay. And, you know, I build upon it, and it's something we give to the editor or we give to our students, you know, this is yours. You can use it however you want. You can modify it however you want. And I encourage people to dive under the hood because it's built in FileMaker Pro, which is something that I spent a large part of my career hoping I would never have to learn. And in retrospect, I really should have learned it sooner because it can do some really cool things, both organizationally and as far as you can get information in and out of the Avid, which can save a lot of time. And so, and a lot of, you'll find a lot of VFX editors tend to be very secretive about their database, and rightly so. They've invested a lot of time building it. They're, you know, they can be as simple as can be, or they can be deeply complex with the world of automation. So I get it. People are not going to be gung-ho to just go take this, you know? So we've built that into our course to be like, here's something that you can take and take it apart, figure out how it works, and build your own, because every project's needs are going to be different. So quite honestly, it's one of those things where there's a certain level of trepidation in that I try to not call it a product, you know, it's not a finished product because every show is going to be a little bit different. And, you know, you get people, I want my continuity done in a different way. I want this in a different way. So it's like, take it. And then when someone says, can you change it? Then change it, you know?
Yeah, have like a bare bones approach, like a workbench that you can alternate and different workflows that you can fit within that. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So this course, I mean, because you guys offer an intro course as well, a 12-part intro course, which it seems really intriguing for someone who, again, is just maybe they haven't done anything in film or anything at all. It's just that they've seen this or someone's talked about this and now they're interested in it. Would that intro course be like the perfect point for someone to get involved with Master the Workflow?
Yes. And the 12-part intro course was designed as sort of a broad strokes, you know, so we offer that for, you know, a very reduced price versus the flagship course, you know, and the intent is that, you know, this is broad strokes, you know, we're going to give you intros to concepts, you know, it would be like reading the cliff notes, you know, of the bigger textbook. And so that's sort of, that was the intent with that is, you know, just real broad strokes. It's almost formatted like a casual discussion between me and Larry. Like here are the things we've learned and here are the things and here's how you're going to use this. And then when you really want to dive in deep, you can move to the flagship course. Mm-hmm. And with the flagship course, one thing we also, always feel the need to mention to members of the Motion Picture Editors Guild is it's currently a part of the contract services reimbursement program. So members of the guild can get the full cost of the course reimbursed through contract services. It's worth noting you have to apply for that reimbursement before you buy the course. Those are the rules of it. But there are options for people who are currently members of the Motion Picture Editors Guild. And we partner with several other groups and try to make, you know, make the course available to, we work with the ACE Intern Committee and other groups, you know, trying to make the course accessible to people.
That's really good. That's really good. And to be fair as well, considering the cost of, say, film school, or like, you are not really going to find this information out anywhere else other than working within the industry. I wouldn't say the price point is actually that intimidating. I know there's courses out there to learn Premiere Pro or Avid or something like Final Cut in itself that costs just as much as your flagship course. So let alone the introductory course, you know?
Absolutely. You know, obviously it's, you know, it's a business and, you know, we went into it, you know, wanting to be able to make something off of it, but certainly Larry and I were very cognizant about, we didn't want to gouge. We didn't, you know, we wanted to be very fair and, you know, and recognize that, you know, a lot of our students are folks who didn't go to film school or perhaps are fresh out of film school. They're not going to be clicking their heels to drop a lot of money. And so, you know, we wanted to be sensitive to that, but at the same time, you know, get people prepared for the field so that they can, so that they can be, you know, when they jump in, you know, when you get that first interview and someone says, can you do this? Can you do this? Can you do that? At least it's not a blind concept because, you know, certainly you're not going to jump into a job and, you know, be ready to run with the confidence of someone who's been assisting for 10 years, but there's going to be a lot of value in, okay, cool. At least they didn't throw a bunch of terminology at me that I don't know. So I go, oh yeah, I can do that. And, you know, we give access to the course and, you know, we give a prolonged access to the course so that, you know, okay, you watched it once, you forgot that thing. Oh yeah, I think the course covers that. Let me go revisit that. So like we encourage you to just, you know, watch it through, but then revisit it, you know, you know, and it is infinitely more accessible now than it's ever been too, because, you know, there was a time when certainly when the Avid software was much more expensive than it is now. Yeah. There was a time when it was primarily hardware based and it was crazily expensive. Mm-hmm. You know, now with even software as, you know, your iMovies and, you know, there's a whole lot of different type of editing too. You know, it's interesting things that would have traditionally been thought of bad form, you know, jump cuts, you know, you look at these online videos and jump cuts, you know, are things that, you know, we would generally avoid in most circumstances. And now it's kind of this ubiquitous thing for online videos. And you got there are more styles of cutting nowadays than ever before. Mm-hmm. And so there is something to be said about, hey, I started for YouTube. Now I want to work on a feature film. Okay, well, cool. You're already somewhat familiar. So let's help you bridge that gap, you know, and you know, kind of it goes back to how I started in unscripted and okay, I don't know feature, mm-hmm. but you know, the Avid, you know, a lot of really great things. Let's bridge that gap and get you in.
Yeah. And also you guys offer more than just the course. There's a lot more that comes with Master the Workflow. Obviously you've got the groups. So maybe you want to kind of just delve into a little bit of that as well. of what you offer.
Yeah, we have a private group just for our members where, you know, people can pose their questions and kind of, you know, if they're struggling with something, we always try to give them as much time as we possibly can. Mm-hmm. You know, and there are, we've set up a, within that group, we also will pass job leads when we get them on occasion so that we can kind of offer, you know, Larry and I tend to get people reaching out going, hey, you know, I'm looking for someone, the pay's a little lower, so I can't really command someone who's been working for 10 years. Do you have a student, like someone who's maybe a little green, but, you know, they might be able to hop in. And so we hear about those, you know, as the course has kind of grown in name a little bit, and we try to offer those to our students, you know, like, hey, this person has been really, you know, really gung-ho and asking a lot of questions. I feel like this is the kind of go-getter you want, you know? And so, you know, there's, out of that has grown its own community. And, you know, and we're also, you know, we, via email, you know, when people run into problems, you know, like, hey, I'm on a show that, you know, this is what's being asked of us, you know, it's always, and that can turn into a difficult thing too, in the sense of like, it's like, well, I can't necessarily be your workflow consultant, but, you know, within reason, we can generally go, huh, I've never run into that. Well, maybe you could do this or that, you know? Yeah. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think, and again, I think that's invaluable. And in a way, you've created a community where the same thing happens, where even once you've purchased this course and you go through it, now you're with other individuals who, again, you make friends with. Now you've got new contacts, and if they go off here, and you end up getting contacted by them later down the line. So, you know, it seems like a good setup that you guys have put together.
And the hope too is by having a community of people who are at approximately the same point in their career, if they get into a situation where, hey, I need someone and I don't know anyone who's working, well, at least we can have some sense of confidence that there's a baseline of understanding that, hey, does anybody in this group, hey, we need someone, you know?
Yeah.
And as, you know, I'm generally not a major advocate for certification. I kind of feel like certificates don't tell you that much about people, but I have been starting to hear people say, oh, they told me they took your course. So, you know, I was like, I think they'd be a good bet. And I go, that's great. You know, I do hope it helps for people. You know, I certainly don't want to impress upon anyone that putting that on your resume or uttering the phrase is going to be any kind of golden ticket to anything. But, you know, I've found that people are also being receptive to that. And I'm hoping that it is becoming more valuable, that, again, like you say, you know, you have a basic, you know, baseline, you know, you're not going in blind, you know?
Yeah. No, I think that's really good. And that's masterworkflow.com.
Correct.
I'll leave a link in the description as well, so people can come and visit, because I highly recommend it.
But
Richard, honestly, thank you so much for your time.
Liam, it's been great.
Yeah, no, I really appreciate it. I've really enjoyed every minute of it. I could sit here and talk for hours if I hours and hours and hours. So yeah, but I really appreciate it, and hopefully we'll catch up in the future and we'll see this course grow. Looking forward to seeing what more content you guys put out, and
honestly, you want information too, reach out anytime, man. Yeah, you know,
appreciate
it. Either, you know, personally or you know, within the capacity of this, you know.
Definitely. I've got your email, so honestly, Richard, thank you so much for your time. Have a great day, and we'll speak soon.
You as well. You be well.
All right, you take care. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.